Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Sound of Music, The Making of America's Favorite Movie by Julia Antopol Hirsch. Foreword by Robert Wise. Narrated by Donna Postel. Foreword. What makes a motion picture a hit around the world? Specifically, what made The Sound of Music the most beloved film of its time? It has been almost 3 decades since the film was released, and I am still being asked that question on an average of twice a week. Frequently, I am also asked to explain the continuing heavy sales of the video cassette version. The answer to all these questions is simple. I don't know. I wish I did, because then I could repeat that success. But to give that simple answer would be to ignore the hard work, the talent, the years of creative effort that were involved, years that stretch back almost 4 decades to when Mary Martin and Richard Holliday convinced Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein II that some German films based on the exploits of the Trapp family singers could form the basis of a Broadway musical. The show turned out to be the most successful of all Rodgers and Hammerstein musicals. That's why I am delighted that Julia Hirsch has invested the time and effort to interview countless people, dig through the archives of 3 universities, and go through thousands of photographs at Fox, seeking answers to the questions that are always asked of me. Ms. Hirsch has done a marvelous job of capturing the joys and frustrations of putting together a successful film. She has also managed, through her use of anecdotes and photographs, to convey some of the wonder the film evokes in audiences of all ages. Looking at the movie from the distance of 3 decades, and through Ms. Hirsch's journalistic eyes, I am reminded that some things simply defy explanation. They just are. Nevertheless, I can tell you what The Sound of Music has meant to me, apart, of course, from the satisfaction that comes from having a big hit. When the project was first proposed, my immediate reaction was one of pleasure mixed with caution. It was an opportunity to do another musical, which I knew I would enjoy. But more than that, a definite challenge was involved. To make a musical so radically different in form and tone from my previous film, West Side Story. That, perhaps, was one of the first things that drew me to music. Another was the chance for a reunion with Saul Chaplin and Ernest Lehman, my associate producer and screenwriter, respectively, on West Side Story. Later, I discovered still another plus, the joy of working with Julie Andrews, a great talent and a delightful human being, who found, as you will discover in the book, ways to make an adventure out of even the most trying circumstances. But nowhere in this book will you find any mention of the one important element for which none of us connected with The Sound of Music could take credit. Timing. It isn't mentioned because it was the X factor, the one thing that no one could depend on and on which no one even wanted to make a guess. The Sound of Music was released in the spring of 1965. The date was not picked arbitrarily, nor was it selected on the basis of some arcane chart. It was released then because, after all the work and the previews, that is simply when it was deemed ready to be shown to the public. And that, of course, was when the question of timing first came to the fore. 1965 was a volatile year in the United States and throughout the world. Newspapers carried headlines of the war in Vietnam. A cultural revolution was beginning to spread throughout the country, and people needed old-fashioned ideals to hold on to. The movie-going public was ready, possibly even eager, for a film like this. Besides an outstanding score and an excellent cast, it had a heartwarming story, good humor, someone to love and someone to hate, and 7 adorable children. There was no question, from the very first week of its release, that the movie was going to be successful, although even those of us closest to the project never dreamed exactly how popular it would be. And ever since then, experts have been dissecting all the elements that Julia Hirsch describes here in an effort to learn if there is a formula for success. I have often been told that if the film had been released 2 years earlier, or 2 years later, the public taste would have been different, and we would not have been so successful. I am not prepared to argue the point, though I am pleased to note that the film's ongoing popularity, even with young audiences, suggests at least a certain timelessness. I am just pleased and proud that we were able to create an entertaining movie that touched so many lives. Robert Wise, October 28, 1992, Beverly Hills, California. Prologue. According to her book, The Story of the Trapp Family Singers, it was in 1933 that 28-year-old Maria von Trapp, visiting a friend in Tyrol, made a fateful wish. The friend, a famous writer, began discussing her profession. "Isn't it funny?" her friend confessed. "I never wrote a word in my life until after I was 40. The next day, as they were hiking in the Alps, the travelers came upon a quaint little chapel that looked down upon an enchanting green valley. Inside the church, Maria, seeing a rope dangling from the opening that led up to the steeple bell, mischievously took hold of the rope and jokingly proclaimed, 'I wish I could become a writer, too, after I'm 40. Maria then pulled the rope, and the sound of the bell echoed throughout the glen. Her friend stared at her incredulously. "Did you know the story?" "Which story?" asked Maria. "Well, the people say that once in 100 years, it happens that if someone rings this bell while pronouncing a wish, that wish, whatever it may be, will come true. The people of this valley call it the wishing bell." 15 years later, Maria von Trapp wrote her first book, The Story of the Trapp Family Singers. 17 years after that, a musical film based on that book changed movie history. 1. Let's start at the very beginning, from Vienna to Hollywood. Maria Augusta Kutschera made her grand entrance into the world in a fashion that would later typify her character: in motion. She was born on January 26, 1905, on a train racing toward Vienna. Already displaying signs of a restless nature, she was just too impatient to wait until the train reached the city, where a staff of doctors would surely be waiting at the hospital. Instead, her mother, Augusta, was forced to recruit a train conductor to act as midwife, and just before the stroke of midnight, he helped deliver Augusta's baby daughter. Augusta died of pneumonia when Maria was 2 years old, and her father left the youngster with an elderly cousin's family so that he could be free to travel throughout Europe. This seemed to be her father's pattern. When his first wife died, he had left Maria's older brother to be raised by the same relatives. Maria was reared in a family of adults, and she became a lonely and unhappy child. The household she lived in was also so strict, and her uncle, who became her legal guardian after her father died, so physically abusive, that she developed a rebellious nature as well. Maria's guardians had brought her up as a socialist and raised her to be cynical toward all religion, but a visiting Jesuit priest who lectured at her college changed her life. His speech had a powerful impact on the vulnerable young student, though Maria still felt compelled to meet the priest a few days later to enlighten him as to all the reasons his beliefs were wrong. But at that meeting, the priest's composure and quiet confidence impressed the romantic young woman, and all her arguments were forgotten. Instead, she found his unwavering faith and utter tranquility the perfect medicine to heal her troubled heart. Maria's newfound religious beliefs became so strong, in fact, that after graduating from college with a degree in education, the once devout atheist traveled to Salzburg, Austria, and joined the Nonnberg Abbey as a postulant. Maria was intensely devoted to the convent, but her dedication did not prevent the former tomboy from getting into mischief. the sudden change from her free-spirited college days of mountain climbing to the more sedate life at the Abbey also seemed to adversely affect her health. One day, the Reverend Mother called Maria to her office. Maria's headaches had worried the Abbey's doctor. He thought she needed exercise and fresh air. So the Mother Abbess had decided to send Maria to the home of retired naval captain Georg von Trapp to be governess to one of his young daughters. The child, also named Maria, had developed rheumatic fever and was forced to spend much of her time in bed. The young postulant accepted her new post only after she received the Reverend Mother's promise that in 9 months she could return to the Abbey for good. But as we all know, Maria never did come back to stay. She married the captain on November 26, 1927, and had 3 children to add to the 7 from his first marriage. The family, whose members seemed to have a natural talent for music and whose voices blended beautifully, began to perform professionally. At the Salzburg festivals, on the radio, and even touring Europe. When Hitler invaded Austria and the captain was called back into service for the Navy of the Third Reich, the family, violently opposed to the Nazi regime, decided to escape. They climbed over the mountains to Italy. From there, they traveled to England, then crossed the ocean to America, where they continued to perform as the famous Trapp family singers. When the young Maria rang that steeple bell, she had no inkling that her innocent wish to become a writer would come true, or that her life would eventually be the subject of 2 German motion pictures, a Broadway play, and the most successful American musical film of all time. But had she known, Maria would not have been surprised. She was a strong personality and a powerful promoter of her family. Mary Martin, who starred as Maria in the Broadway musical, wrote in her autobiography, My Heart Belongs, "I came to the conclusion that perhaps the family didn't just climb that mountain to escape. She pushed them all the way up." Promoting her family was one of the reasons Maria wrote The Story of the Trapp Family Singers in 1948. Soon after the book was published, Hollywood beckoned. But the producers wanted to buy only the title of her book, and Maria turned them down flat. They'd have to buy the whole story or nothing. According to Maria's autobiography, Maria, in 1956, German producer Wolfgang Reinhardt, son of the famous film director Max Reinhardt, approached Maria with a contract for $10,000 to buy the rights to her entire story. That was a tidy sum to a widow with 10 children. The captain had died in 1947. But Maria's lawyer suggested that she also ask for royalties. Heeding his advice, Maria met again with the producer's agent and asked for a share of the movie's profits. The agent hesitated and said he'd have to call Germany and ask Reinhardt's permission. He came back shortly and said, "I am sorry. I have to inform you that there is a law in existence which forbids a German film company from paying royalties to foreigners." Maria was now an American citizen. Maria took the man at his word and didn't even verify his story with her lawyer. She signed the contract and at the same time unknowingly signed away all film rights, including all profit participation, to her story. Not only had the agent misled her, no such law existed, but he actually called her a few weeks later and suggested that if she would agree to take $9,000 instead of the full $10,000, he could give the entire amount to her immediately. She needed the cash and made the deal. Die Trapp Familie was produced in Germany in 1956 and became a big hit. It did so well that Reinhardt followed it up in 1958 with a sequel titled Die Trapp Familie in America. Both movies starred Ruth Lewerick as Maria and Hans Holt as the captain and were directed by Wolfgang Liebeneiner. They soon became the most successful films produced in Germany since World War II and subsequently became hits in Europe and South America as well. Paramount Pictures in Hollywood purchased the U.S. film rights to the two movies, hoping to produce an English-language version, as a vehicle for its young star, Audrey Hepburn. At the time, Paramount had just signed Broadway and television director Vincent Donahue to a contract with no specific project in mind. One of the first things they showed him was the film Die Trapp Familie. Donahue sat watching the picture in Paramount's projection room, and when the lights went up, he turned to John Mock, story editor at Paramount, and said, "I think this would make a great vehicle for Mary Martin." Donahue had directed Mary Martin in the national tour of Annie Get Your Gun, along with the television version of the musical. He'd also worked with Martin in the stage and television versions of The Skin of Our Teeth and two other television specials. Donahue, Martin, and Martin's husband, producer Richard Halliday, had been looking for another project to work on together for the Broadway stage. Donahue flew the film back to New York and screened it for Martin and her husband. They fell in love with the idea and began working on the project. By the time they went to buy the rights, however, Paramount had dropped its option and no longer owned the rights to the German films. So Halliday, unaware of Maria's deal with the German producers, thought he had to go through Maria to get permission. Maria, who was involved in missionary work in New Guinea at the time, soon began receiving strange notes from an American producer saying he wanted to turn her story into a Broadway play starring Mary Martin. Maria received three of these notes, and each time she got one, she tore it up. She didn't know who Mary Martin was, and she thought the whole idea of a play based on her book was preposterous. When Maria returned from New Guinea, an undaunted Richard Halliday was waiting to meet her ship in San Francisco. He invited her to see his wife's performance in Annie Get Your Gun that evening. Maria loved the show and afterward went backstage to meet Mary Martin. From the moment they met, Maria and the future Maria felt they were kindred souls. But unfortunately, the real Maria von Trapp had no say in whether or not Halliday could buy the rights to the book. Reinhardt's company in Germany had seen to that. So Halliday and his partner Leland Hayward made a deal with the German producer. And although legally the American producers didn't owe Maria a penny, they voluntarily gave her 3/8 of 1% in royalties on the Broadway show. It was more than Maria expected, and she was grateful. Initially, Martin and Halliday conceived of their version of Die Trapp Familie as a straight dramatic play, using the actual folk songs and religious numbers the Trapp family sang on tour. So they hired playwrights Howard Lindsay and Russell Krauss, whose previous successes had included Life with Father and State of the Union, for which they had won the Pulitzer, to write the stage play. The writing team had also produced many shows on Broadway, including Arsenic and Old Lace. After securing Lindsay and Krauss, Halliday and Martin approached the legendary composing team of Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein II and asked them to write one original song for Martin to sing in the play. But Rodgers and Hammerstein thought that mixing the two styles of music, theirs with authentic Austrian folk songs, would be like mixing oil and water. They did, however, offer to write an entirely fresh new score and to act as co-producers of the show. The one stipulation they had was that Halliday and company wait until Rodgers and Hammerstein completed work on their current project, Flower Drum Song. Halliday and Martin decided it was worth the wait to get the talented duo on board. The Sound of Music opened at the Lundfontein Theater in New York on November 16, 1959. The reviews ranged from indifference to loathing. The critics found it too sweet and saccharine, terms that would later haunt the film version, but the audience must have had a sweet tooth because they ate it up. As Richard Rodgers wrote years later, "It's my conviction that anyone who can't, on occasion, be sentimental about children, home, or nature is sadly maladjusted." The show ran on Broadway for 1,443 performances, won 6 Tony Awards, including Best Musical, and sold more than 3 million cast albums. Martin's popularity was a big contribution to the show's success. Even before the play opened, the box office had garnered $2 million in advance ticket sales. For 1959, when theater ticket prices hovered around $5, a $2 million advance was a notable beginning. On opening night, legendary motion picture agent Irving Swifty Lazar, who represented the show's writers, Rogers, Hammerstein, Lindsay, and Krause, was sitting in the audience with the president of 20th Century Fox, Spiros Skouras. Skouras was there because his studio had right of first refusal on any new Rogers and Hammerstein musical. 20th Century Fox had adapted 3 Rogers and Hammerstein shows as motion pictures: South Pacific, Carousel, and The King and I. When Fox purchased The King and I, it also acquired the right to option any subsequent Rogers and Hammerstein properties before the other studios had a chance to do so. As Skouras sat watching the play, Swifty Lazar watched his client, wanting to gauge the studio chief's reaction to the show. By the middle of the play, Lazar had no doubts. "He was crying like a baby," the agent recalled, "and I knew I had a customer." But Lazar and Skouras were not the only Hollywood visitors to realize the musical's film potential. 2 weeks after it opened, screenwriter Ernest Lehman went to see the show. Lehman had begun his career working in the office of a theatrical press agent in New York, where he learned the ins and outs of show business. He turned this knowledge into numerous magazine articles, short stories, and novelettes, including a novelette that he later adapted as a movie, Sweet Smell of Success. A novelette, The Comedian, which followed success, brought him to the attention of Hollywood, and he was summoned to the West Coast. His first screenplay was Executive Suite at MGM. The director of the film was a man with whom Lehman would establish strong ties as both a friend and collaborator on 4 films, Robert Wise. Following his successful Hollywood debut, Lehman went on to write the screenplays of such classics as North by Northwest and Somebody Up There Likes Me. In addition, he penned the screen adaptations of Sabrina, The King and I, West Side Story, and Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. During the intermission of The Sound of Music, Lehman and his wife rushed to a nearby Howard Johnson's restaurant for a quick bowl of soup. Over a cup of steaming clam chowder, Lehman turned to his wife and said, "I don't care what anyone says about this show. Someday, it's going to make a very successful movie." When he returned to California, he repeated this statement to David Brown, story editor at 20th Century Fox. In June 1960, 7 months after the show had opened, 20th Century Fox exercised its option and bought the rights to The Sound of Music for $1.25 million against 10% of the gross. Lazar had certainly found a willing customer. At that time, this was the largest sum a studio had ever spent on a literary property. Fox also protected its investment by purchasing a 6-year option on the U.S. release of the 2 German films, Die Trapp Familie and Die Trapp Familie in America. Fox combined these 2 movies into one, hired Lee Kressel to dub the film in English, retitled it The Trapp Family, and released it in the United States in March 1961. Once again, the critics found the story as light as Wonder Bread. A reviewer from Daily Variety wrote that its uncompromisingly sentimental nature has a tendency to slop over into naivete. Shades of reviews to come. Fox's contract with Rogers et al. Stipulated that the film of its musical could not be released in the United States or Canada until all first-class stage presentations of the musical have closed in such countries, or December 31, 1964, whichever is earlier. So even though Fox paid a handsome price for The Sound of Music, the property was put on hold. And while it lingered on the shelf, the studio's finances, which had begun tumbling in the mid-50s, took a nosedive. In fact, the only reason Fox had been able to purchase the property in the first place was the standard industry practice of paying in installments. The contract, dated May 31, 1961, although the deal was made a year earlier, called for the payment to be made as follows. $125,000 paid in December 1961, $100,000 payable June 30, 1962, $823,850 after worldwide release, and $201,150 to be paid in 9 installments of $22,350 each on each anniversary of the release date. If 10% of the gross exceeded $1.25 million, then the additional payments would be made quarterly. The rights would expire on December 31, 1977. Fox's financial troubles began in 1956, when Daryl Zanuck left for Paris to start his own independent production company. Zanuck, who had founded the film company 20th Century and had then merged with Fox Films to create 20th Century Fox, had once been the guiding light of the studio. But after his departure, a succession of studio heads came and went, all supervised by Fox president Spiros Skouras. Unstable leadership, however, was not the studio's only problem. By the late 50s, the studio had had a series of failures at the box office. To make matters worse, television had by then become the most popular form of entertainment, which spelled poison for the entire motion picture business. At the same time, location shooting was becoming the most cost-effective way to make pictures, and the old studio system was becoming obsolete. Things finally got so bad for Fox that in 1957, Skouras even flirted with the notion of giving up the Fox lot completely and simply renting studio space at MGM over in Culver City. This would have meant giving up both its status as a major studio and its industry muscle. But instead of shutting down the entire studio, Skouras began drawing up plans to sell off 260 acres of the studio's backlot property, which eventually became the master-planned business and shopping community, Century City. If Skouras hesitated at all to go ahead with the Century City deal, explained Richard Tyler Jordan in a 1989 Los Angeles magazine article, one out-of-control project convinced him to push the deal through. Skouras told Edmund Hersher, his director of property development, "I need $48 million. That damn Cleopatra has put me in such a fix." His Cleopatra problems began in September 1960, just 3 months after the studio paid its phenomenal price for The Sound of Music. Skouras announced the beginning of principal photography on what he thought would be a $2 million quickie to star Joan Collins as the Egyptian queen. But what he got instead was an all-star boondoggle that turned into one of the highest-priced movie failures of all time. It was a film destined to become more famous for bringing together Elizabeth Taylor and Richard Burton than for its dubious contribution to the annals of motion picture history. Every calamity that could befall a motion picture struck Cleopatra. Taylor contracted pneumonia, forcing production to close down for 6 months. Two major roles had to be recast. Directors quit, the producer was fired, and while the affair between new lovers Taylor and Burton sizzled on screen and off, their escapades proved costly to a production already way over budget. The movie wasn't even completed, and it had already cost the studio nearly $40 million in 1963 dollars. As the costs spiraled out of control, Fox's board of directors forced Skouras out of his position as president and gave him the nominal title chairman of the board. Then, like a knight in shining armor, Daryl Zanuck returned to reclaim his castle. He was a major stockholder in the company, and so had a lot to lose if the studio went bankrupt. He also wanted to protect the distribution of his new movie, The Longest Day, which Fox was releasing. But even though the gallant knight had returned to save the kingdom, he didn't want to live there. Or he couldn't. There was a rumor circulating around town that the separation agreement he'd made with his wife, Virginia, had stipulated that Daryl could not enter California unless Virginia gave him permission. Whether or not this was true, Daryl ran the studio from either the George V Hotel in Paris, or if he had to be in the country for a board meeting, the St. Regis Hotel in New York. As for the studio in Los Angeles, he appointed his son, Richard Dick Zanuck, vice president in charge of production at the California location. Dick Zanuck had grown up on the Fox lot and was already a seasoned Hollywood veteran at the ripe old age of 27, having produced two motion pictures, Compulsion, the classic film adaptation about the Leopold and Loeb murder case, and The Chapman Report, a George Cukor film starring a very young Jane Fonda, about the sexual mores of suburban women. After this notable beginning, Zanuck became his father's West Coast liaison to the independent film company Daryl had started in France. When Dick Zanuck returned to Fox after his father regained control of the studio in 1963, it seemed like a different company. Instead of the productive, vital studio he had known in his youth, Zanuck soon discovered he had inherited a chaotic studio on the brink of bankruptcy. The new head of production blamed many of the studio's troubles on bad management. "When I came back to Fox, they had all these projects and people, and nothing was happening. I read 30 scripts the first few days I was there, and there wasn't one thing that was any good." Zanuck's first step was to shut down the studio. Only a handful of projects were left in production. 1,000 employees were laid off, and even the commissary closed down. He then corralled everyone onto one floor of one building to gather momentum. By all accounts, 20th Century Fox became a ghost town. Tumbleweeds were rolling down the streets, Zanuck recalled. "It was a haunted studio," concurred Ernest Lehman. But while the studio looked as if it were about to declare Chapter 11, Dick Zanuck knew he would somehow find a way to bring it back around. "I know there was a big concern at the time as to whether or not we would ever open up the studio again," related Zanuck, "but by the film community, not by us. We still had some money for production, and we had every intention of opening up again. We knew that we would." Zanuck had a few projects in various stages of development, among them What a Way to Go, to star Shirley MacLaine and an all-star cast, and Something's Got to Give, which was to have starred Marilyn Monroe before she died, and was now retitled Move Over, Darling, for Doris Day and James Garner. The Sand Pebbles was in the early stages of development, with Robert Wise as director. Two other films, The Agony and the Ecstasy, and Those Magnificent Men in Their Flying Machines, were in development and would eventually be shot in Europe at the same time as music. Zanuck also knew that he needed a major project to put the studio back on the map. The solution was there all along. The Sound of Music had been collecting dust since its purchase by Fox, yet it was still a tremendous hit on Broadway. Zanuck couldn't understand why no one had put the project into development. "I just thought it was such a wonderful piece of family entertainment, and it had been so hugely successful that it was just an obvious thing to do." Once again, Zanuck questioned the studio's former management. Even though the studio couldn't release the picture until the play closed, they could have put a rider on it. "What you want to do is have your movie ready for release when your date comes." There wasn't much overhead involved in putting a property into development. It just meant hiring a writer. Ernest Lehman had made it known around town that he was very optimistic about the possibility of a movie based on music, and that he was anxious to do the adaptation. His big successes with adaptations of The King and I and West Side Story convinced Zanuck to let Lehman work his magic again on music. This would be the film to herald the new regime at 20th Century Fox. When The Hollywood Reporter and Daily Variety announced on December 10, 1962, that Fox had hired Ernest Lehman to work on The Sound of Music, the news reverberated throughout Hollywood. Not only had Fox eluded bankruptcy, it actually intended to make an expensive major film. Hollywood was skeptical. First of all, no one thought that Fox had the money. In fact, Lehman was getting warnings from friends. "Fox is using you," they said. "They're not going to pay you. They're reneging on their contracts." Even the board of directors at Fox didn't have confidence in its own project, fearing the movie would be too costly. Then, something happened that changed the directors' minds. Lehman and Zanuck had a lunch date at Romanov's. "It was our first meeting," Lehman remembered. "I got to the table first, and I saw Irving Lazar approach Dick at the top of the stairs. They were huddled in conversation for a while. And then Zanuck came to the table. Swifty just offered me $2 million to buy back the rights to music," Zanuck told Lehman. "I told him to go to hell." Lazar wouldn't mention the name of his client, but Lehman and Zanuck were convinced it was Jack Warner. It seems the rumors about Fox were so bad that Warner thought the studio couldn't possibly afford to make the picture, and he thought his studio might do well with the project. His offer of $2 million to buy out the Rodgers and Hammerstein contract would have provided 20th Century Fox with a $750,000 profit. Warner thought the studio was hungry enough to bite. Instead, Fox's board of directors gave Zanuck the okay to begin production. But it wasn't just Fox's financial troubles that made the film community question Lehman's sanity in taking on the project. It was the project itself. Reputations die hard, and The Sound of Music was still known for its schmaltz. Lehman recalled sitting in the newly reopened commissary one day when Burt Lancaster, who had starred in Lehman's critically acclaimed Sweet Smell of Success, walked up and asked what he was working on. When Lehman replied, "The Sound of Music," Lancaster retorted, "Jesus, you must need the money." Another example of the community's distaste for the play came from director Billy Wilder. Wilder and Lehman, guests at Jack Lemmon's home one night, began discussing Lehman's upcoming projects. When Lehman told Wilder that he had just started working on music, Wilder announced to his friend, "No musical with swastikas in it will ever be a success." This is precisely the reason Lehman wrote the scene in which Captain Von Trapp rips up the swastika. As Lehman began developing the screenplay, he and Zanuck decided they'd better start looking for a director-producer. They immediately thought of Robert Wise. Wise was known as a gritty, realistic director, and they felt that his style of filmmaking would help compensate for the more sugary aspects of the story. Wise had also just directed and produced the highly acclaimed film adaptation of West Side Story, for which he had won double Oscars for Best Picture and Best Director, the latter Oscar he shared with co-director Jerome Robbins. But Wise was already on the Fox lot, preparing The Sand Pebbles, a sprawling adventure about the lives of a U.S. Navy gunboat crew in 1926 China. The picture was only in the early stages of development, and Wise could have left to do Fox's music, but he wanted to stay with The Sand Pebbles. Besides, Wise wasn't particularly interested in music. He'd also heard the rumors. "It's not his cup of tea," his agent said. Lehman's second choice was director Stanley Donen. Donen had directed such classic musicals as Singin' in the Rain, co-directed with Gene Kelly, Funny Face, and Damn Yankees. But when Lehman called him at his home in Switzerland to ask if he'd be interested in directing music, Donen declined. Though he had been an investor in the Broadway show, he had no interest in directing the film. Lehman then approached Gene Kelly. In addition to dancing and acting in more than 30 films, Kelly was an accomplished director. He'd directed On the Town and Singin' in the Rain with Donnan, as well as Invitation to the Dance. He seemed an excellent choice for music, and Lehman was excited as he drove to Kelly's Beverly Hills home on Rodeo Drive. As soon as I walked in...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.